Welcome back to Mission Control Houston after that video about Karen Nyberg and a little peek into what it's like to be an astronaut with a family on the ground. We have with us today Doug Hurley, her husband, also an astronaut. Welcome, Doug.
That's great to be here, Kelly.
So, you know, there's great things about being an astronaut and flying in space that I personally will never get to experience, but you guys both have had the opportunity to do that. We're really curious about what it's like, though, when your loved one is away for a long trip like this. You know, there are many, many people in this country, in this world, who have to spend long periods away from their family, armed forces folks in particular. Tell us a little bit about what it's like to be away from your wife for so long and how you manage having a child, your son Jack, on the ground when she's up there.
Yeah, it's obviously a question I get a lot. You know, the first thing I'll say is the military folks, you know this very, very well. And obviously, having been in the Marine Corps for 25 years, I experienced several deployments, but I wasn't married, didn't have kids. So this is a little different being on the other end of it as well, you know, being the one that's home. You know, I understand, you know, why she loves it so much, loves the job, because it's the same thing I do, and so that part of it is really easy. But I also understand the risks. I also understand the, you know, the lengths of time, the things that can happen. But we have such a great support system here, you know, with the video conferences on a weekly basis and the IP phone. So it's really good to stay connected, really easy to stay connected. So that part of it has been really nice, and we have a great bunch of folks that support us through that, through the entire increment, and that really makes a difference.
Well, let's just focus this a little bit for the early days. How did you and Karen meet in the first place?
Well, we were classmates, ASCANS together in 2000, and, you know, eventually that blossomed into something more, and, you know, once again, I think, you know, we have similar career goals. We had similar backgrounds. We grew up in very small towns. And so we had a lot of common background, if you will. And then the other part of it was just, you know, she's an amazing person. I mean, she's beautiful. She's smart, way smarter than the average bear. I mean, especially for a Marine fighter pilot. And you know, we just hit it off from day one, and it's been wonderful ever since.
So you and she have both flown shuttle flights and been apart from each other on short duration missions prior to this. But now you're into a long duration mission. You have a son. Tell us a little bit about Jack and how old he is and how you guys have been dealing with that long distance parenting thing.
Yeah, the training flow for long duration kind of prepares you for some of this, because it starts, you know, 2.5 or 3 years before the flight starts. So these little four, and I call them little, it's your perspective, I think. these little 4, 6, 7 week training trips get you at least somewhat prepared for this big trip, which is ultimately ends up being close to 7 months in our case, because she had to leave to do a last training trip in Russia before even going to Kazakhstan for the launch, and then, of course, the 5.5 months in orbit. So it's it helps get you ready for that. And of course, you know, with today's modern conveniences of iPads and Skype and FaceTime and those things, I think Jack from day one has been used to that. I actually found out we were going to have Jack just prior to flying on STS-127, which was my first flight. And I watched her fly on STS-124. We had started dating by then in 2008. And I told her when she got back that it was a lot easier to be the one on the rocket than the one watching somebody go. And I think most families would attest to that same thing. And I think there are folks in our office that you know, maybe don't appreciate that quite as much as she and I do. So it is much easier being the one going into space in that particular case than it is the one watching somebody go, because you're the one that, you know, you have no control over your destiny at that point. It's all up to physics and what your spouse does. But it helped us get ready for this one, which obviously is a little different than a shuttle mission. You know, this truly is a long duration mission. It's a long time away, family separation, those kinds of things. So in the lead up to it with the training, you know, we came up with ways, I think, like every family does when they're separated, to just kind of connect and stay connected and what worked, and then also trying to work around Jack's schedule, which obviously you can't, you know, with the time change and all those things, you can't manipulate his schedule So Karen had to adjust, you know, her schedule for times that she wanted to talk to him or video with him.
Okay. Well, so chasing down a youngster Jack's age is not always easy. Can you tell us, can you give us a little insight into what it's like to prepare for one of those calls from Karen to make sure that they connect appropriately?
Yeah, I think part of it is just he's known this almost since he was old enough to remember anything. And so he's used to being able to talk to mom on an iPad. So that part of it is easy. I think the only difference now is we can't do this every day. We can do it weekly. But like I said, with the tremendous amount of support we get here, those video conferences are priceless. And of course, they're huge for Karen to just be able to interact with Jack. You know, having anybody who knows, who's had young children, knows that they change every day at this age. And so it was very important to her, obviously, to stay connected with him as much as possible. You know, I'll typically send videos or pictures every day of Jack to her, and then she always sends a video down every night for him that she makes. So, you know, it's not without a lot of effort, but it's obviously worth it because I think, you know, that way we will stay connected and there won't be that unfamiliarity that I think sometimes, you know, with the military deployments happen where you can't stay this connected. So we're really lucky in that regard.
We are coming up on Karen's 1,000th day, I believe.
100th day.
100th day. 100th
I think
day.
It's today.
Yeah, it's today.
I think it's today.
And
yeah.
So we're actually looking at a picture of her live as she's working in the Kibo module of the International Space Station right now. Are you starting to count the days to when she comes home?
I'm not going to admit to anything here, Kelly. But yeah, obviously, you know, it feels like it's been 100 days for me. I'm sure for her, it probably has gone by pretty fast. Remembering my shuttle flights, it just seemed like those missions went by in almost a blink of an eye. I'd say there's a little bit of that. But, you know, I'm just so proud of what she's done and how she's represented herself and NASA. It's a great crew up there, you know, with Luca and Chris and Pavel and everybody, Fyodor. And I think they're looking forward to, you know, obviously, the next crew and then the 9 folks they'll have there towards the end of the increment. Going to be sad to see Chris go. And obviously I know Chris pretty well cause I flew with him on STS-127. So I'm sure he's kind of going through those kind of the end of the mission, you know, the tug of war between, yeah, I'm excited to go home, but it's going to be hard to leave this place. And I think if you've gotten the most out of your mission, that's how you're going to feel towards the end of it.
Okay. One last question before we wrap this up. Have you had any incidents with your son that led to mom having to say, Jack, he got to do this? Or has it gotten to that point? Or do you try and stay away from that kind of a thing?
Well, yeah. I think, you know, he's I know all parents say this, but he's a pretty good kid. And he's very adaptable to the kind of the way things have been. This is all he's ever known is, he was born in February and Karen was assigned to this flight in that, you know, a few months later in July. So, and started traveling, you know, overseas shortly thereafter. So since he was less than a year old, this is all he's ever known. I think it's going to be more interesting to see what it's like in a couple of years when, you know, both of us are around all the time. But no, you know, he's been super. And it's kind of hard to do that. You know, by the time you have an episode or whatever, you know, anecdote you had to tell her, you know, by the time you see her again on the video conferences, there's already 4 or 5 things that's happened since then. So that's why I try to send pictures or videos of him every day so she can just kind of see the progression of, you know, when she last saw him in late April to in November.
Yeah, when she gets home, he'll have grown.
I think he already has quite a bit. That's what I was trying to see if we could just say, hey, slow down a little bit. Don't grow too much more before she gets back. But he's not listening.
And I'm sure he'll have learned a lot, too.
Yeah, some of it may be. Yeah, probably his vocabulary may have gone a little bit towards the Marine Corps, maybe a little more than it should. But other than that, he's doing really well.
All right. Well, Doug Hurley, thanks a whole lot for being with us here today and sharing this personal side of your relationship with your wife and your son in this unusual set of circumstances. It's really nice of you and Karen to share this with the folks out there who are interested in what it's like to be an astronaut and to do all this important research on the space station. You guys make it possible to do that kind of thing with your sacrifices. And I know the country appreciates what you're doing.
Well, thanks. You know, the thing I'd like to just leave folks with is, you know, we're regular folks who have a really cool job, and the rest of it is we're just like a couple working parents, just like everybody else is. So, you know, we just get to ride a rocket every now and again.
All right. Doug Hurley, thanks a lot. And
thanks,
remember
Kelly.
That you can keep track of Karen Nyberg's flight on the space station website at www.nasa.gov/station. And you can follow her on Twitter at @AstroKarenN. There's also lots of information on the International Space Station Facebook account and elsewhere available to you. And we'll keep you in track of her progress here on Space Station Live as well.